ஸ்கிரீன் விசிபிளா இருக்கல மேடம்.
எஸ் சார், விசிபிள் சார்.
ஓகே. சோ எஸ்டர்டே somebody asked a question about prime ideals in C0. So there is a nice article. So this article I'll share in our WhatsApp group. So it is about prime ideals of C01. So if you look at the first paragraph, it is well known that the set C01 of real valued continuous function and the closed interval 0, 1 has a natural ring structure. Its maximal ideals are known to be points. So yesterday we saw that the maximal ideals are a set of all continuous functions vanishing at one particular point. They are maximal ideals that we verified yesterday. And in this paper, they are saying that here we show that although there exist prime ideals which are not maximal. So in this C01, there are prime ideals which are not maximal, but they are contained in a unique maximal ideal. Okay, so I will share the link to this paper in our WhatsApp group, but it is very elementary, not very hi-fi stuff, easy to understand paper. Okay, so you can just have a look at it. It's very interesting paper. Okay, so anything appearing in this resonance, it is very much concept oriented. It will be very helpful. Okay, so you get this journal called Resonance. It is published by Indian Academy of Sciences. Okay, so mostly the topics covered in this resonance are kind of general articles. You can check for general articles in the resonance. Okay, so let's move on to today's session. So yesterday we were talking about
hello
participants, please unmute.
Hello?
Mute yourself.
Hello?
Vignesh, sir.
I think somebody is speaking.
Yes, sir. Then now it is okay. Okay, sir.
Okay, madam. Thank you. Okay, so yesterday we saw that C01. What is this? This is a set of all functions F from closed to 0, 1 to R such that F is continuous. Okay. So from closed 0, 1 to R, all the continuous function you collect, that is we denoted by C0, 1. Similarly, now like here we are looking at closed 0, 1 with a usual metric. Okay. And in the codomain we have R with usual metric. So we can generalize this notion. Like you take X to be arbitrary topological space. So even though I am saying a topological space, we are not going to do any topology. Okay, it is, no need to worry about topology. If you don't know much about topology, it is fine. Whatever we're going to do, it is similar to what we saw in case of C01. Okay, so let X be a topological space. Cx, r, this is set of all continuous functions from the topological space X to R. Okay. So now this is a topological space. So now R with a usual metric. So that will give you a topology called usual topology. Okay, R with usual topology. This X is a topological space. So if you have a function from one topological space to another topological space, it is said to be continuous if inverse image of open set is open. Okay, that is the definition of continuous function between topological spaces. Okay, because if it is an arbitrary topological space, there is no guarantee that there will be a metric here in X. Okay, so it is not that every topology is coming from metric. Okay, so for example, if you look at the usual topology on R, that is by definition it is coming from the usual metric. Okay, but there are many topologies which are not coming from some metric. Okay, there are many topologies which are not coming from some metric. Okay, so there are two kind of topologies. One is called like a metrizable, non-metrizable. Okay, so if you remember in our when I teach sequence of functions, if you remember, we did some calculations like this. So we look at R power R and we take the product topology. Maybe instead of R, I think we had R power close 0, 1. And in the problem, it is given that consider R power close 0, 1 in the product topology. And they gave a sequence of function Fn. And they asked us to find the point-wise limit, okay? So the limit of that sequence. Then we shown that the product topology and the point-wise convergence are same. Okay, so like so point-wise convergence in the sequence of functions, that is a matricable. Anyway, like this matricable topology is like one important concept. One thing you have to remember is there are topologies which are not coming from some metric. Okay, so let's see examples of CX, R. We want to do anyway in theory. So just to take tau to be empty set and the whole set. Okay. So if it is a topology, what is the meaning of topology on a set X? So topology means, so the tau is said to be a topology if first this set tau contains subsets of X. Okay. And the empty set should be there, whole set should be there, and then it should satisfy two conditions. Arbitrary union of sets here should be again here, and a finite intersection of sets here should be here. Okay. So now if you take only these two elements, just two sets, empty set and the whole set, this will satisfy all the property of topology. Okay, therefore it is at X with these two open sets. This is a these two sets. This will define a topology called indiscrete topology. Indiscrete topology. So there is something called a discrete topology. So discrete topology means you take all the subsets of X, that will be called a discrete topology. And indiscrete topology means you take only the empty set and X. Okay. So now what we want to do is, so you take this X to be this X with this topology. Okay. So for the domain, you take X with the indiscrete topology and codomain R with usual topology. What is CX, R? That is what we want to understand. So if you fix this topology in the domain, which functions are continuous as a function from X to R? That is what we want to understand. After that, we want to understand when this CX, R will be an integral domain. Okay. So like, for example, C0, 1 is not an integral domain. That is a one repeated CSIR problem. And then C prime of close 0, 1, continuously differentiable on close 0, 1, that is not integral domain. So to see those results, we do this general, the CX, R, then this is proving, okay? Yeah. So now you take an arbitrary function F from X to R. Note that in the domain X, only two sets are open. Only empty set is open and whole set X is open. Okay. So you take a function F from X to R. Suppose this function is continuous. What is the meaning this function is continuous? So inverse image of every open set is open. That is the definition of continuous function. So F inverse of U is open in tau here. For all open sets U in the codomain. So now if you noticed, so this is an arbitrary function, okay, not necessarily onto, okay. For example, the range of F, if it's a function from X to R, suppose range of F, so F map all the point X to only positive real number, suppose, okay. That is one possibility, okay? So yeah, this function F might map all the point X to only positive real numbers, okay? So in that case, what happens is, if you take a neighborhood in the, for example, you consider the open neighborhood, -2, -1, okay? So this is a neighborhood in the negative real number. So if you look at the inverse image of this neighborhood, it will be empty set. Okay, because we have, if we assume that this function f take x2, every element of x2 positive numbers, then this no points in the x mapped to this interval. Therefore, the inverse image of this set will be empty. Okay. So why we are needing this observation is, if you look at the inverse image of any open set, it might be empty. Inverse image of some open set can be empty. If it is empty, it is fine, because empty set is open set. So U is a open set, inverse image of open set is open. In that case, the condition is satisfied. Okay. So now note that if F is continuous, then F inverse of U should be open in X, but what are the open set in X? Only empty set and whole set. Therefore, this F inverse of U should be empty set, or F inverse of U should be whole set. These are the only possibility. Now, this means that what is the meaning of F inverse of U equal to empty? We just saw that F inverse of U equal to empty means that this open set U intersection range of F is empty, or F inverse of U equal to X means that F of X equal to U. Okay. So you just simply send F this side. That is what we want. Okay. Okay. So why do we need this observation is, like, we want to understand what are the functions from X to R which are continuous. Okay. So if you have a function F, which is, if it is continuous, then that function satisfies these two properties. So using this condition, we check what are the properties the function F should satisfy in order to continuous. Okay. So we assume that suppose there are two distinct points in the function range of F. Okay. So now you consider, so these are real numbers because they are coming from the range. Range is a subset of codomain. For us, codomain is R. So these two are two distinct real numbers. So I take two distinct real numbers from R. Then I consider the open ball center at A of radius, distance between A and B by 2. Okay. So if you draw this neighborhood, this point B will not belongs to this neighborhood. Okay. Because we are collecting only the points that of distance mod A minus B by 2 from the point A, okay, but B will be at the distance mod A minus B, okay. Since we are dividing by 2, this B will not belongs to U1. Similarly, A will not belongs to U2. So what happens is, we have two points A and B. So this neighborhood to U1, this neighborhood, this is U1, this is U2. So these we, so there are two neighborhoods which separating these two points. So basically this means that it is a Hausdorff topological spaces. Hausdorff means that if you give two distinct points, there will be a two disjoint neighborhoods which are separating them. Okay, for example, like that is why I have chosen the radius like this. So these two neighborhoods U1 and U2 will be like this. Okay, so U1 will be a neighborhood of U, A, neighborhood of A. This neighborhood will not intersect this neighborhood. Okay, so these are all open neighborhoods. So we are looking at point inside. Okay. Okay, so now if you A belongs to U1, now observe that this A is a point in the neighborhood U1. So A belongs to U1. Therefore, for U1, this condition is not satisfied because A belongs. So A is a point we are taken from range of F, right? Therefore, A belongs to U1. Therefore, range of F intersection U is non-empty because A belongs to U as well as A belongs to range of F. Therefore, range of F intersection U1 is non-empty. In other words, so if this is not true, then this should be true. Okay. Therefore, F of X should be equal to U1. Okay. We are getting only F of X subset of U1. That is our first observation. Similarly, if you look at B, if you look at the another neighborhood U2, so B belongs to this neighborhood, this neighborhood U2. Therefore, range of F intersection U2 is non-empty. Therefore, by our this observation, this is, if this is not true, then this has to be true. Okay. therefore f of x is contained in u2. So what we have proved is, so you have a function f, so if this function f is continuous, then range should be contained in here as well as range should be contained in here. Okay, so from this it is like you can conclude that like u1 should be equal to u2, okay, because range cannot be contained in two different open sets. Okay, so now these two neighborhoods are equal, means that because they have the same radius, so these two points has to be equal. So these two points are equal means, so I take arbitrary two elements from the range, and I have proved that these two elements has to be equal. That means that in range you cannot find two distinct points. That means that range has only one element. That means that range is a single time set. That means that the function has to be a constant function. Okay, yeah, so therefore we conclude that only constant functions are continuous. So cx are consist of constant functions if x is indiscriminate. Therefore constant functions mean for each real number r you will have a constant function. Okay, so for each point alpha belongs to r, you will have constant function alpha here. Okay, so this will give us a bijection. So c of x comma r is isomorphic to r as a field, I mean isomorphic to r, but r is a field, therefore c x comma r is also a field. Okay, so maybe I'll share the notes, you look at it once again. Now for the second.
Sir, here you have taken the real valued function. I just want to can we take any arbitrary topological space instead of R? So it is also going to be a constant function, right?
Right. We need Hausdorff.
Yeah, Hausdorff topological space. Okay.
Right. Yeah. But sort of I used connectedness also.
Connectedness. Okay. The constant thing, right?
Right. That is why image cannot contain in two separate open sets.
Okay, so I need a topological space which is connected plus Hausdorff.
Yes, yeah, but then it is immediate.
Okay.
Yeah, so then there is nothing to prove there. Like that's, I mean, intuitively that is clear, that is true. Okay. Okay. Now let's look at discrete topology. Discrete topology means you take power set of x, so all the subsets of x are open. Okay, so now, so we are looking at the functions f from x to r. Now x is a discrete topology means all the subsets of x are open. Okay, now if you take any arbitrary function f from x to r and you take a open set u in the codomain, and if you look at the inverse image, this f inverse of u is a subset of x, but here every subset is open, therefore this subset of x is also open. Okay, so what we are concluding is, in the domain if you have discrete topology, then all the functions from x to r are continuous. Okay, so in the earlier case only constant functions are continuous. Now now what we are having is, so only all the functions are continuous. Now here cxr is isomorphic to a field, therefore it has no zero divisors. Now all the functions are continuous, right? So cx comma r is isomorphic to r power x. R power x means set of all functions from x to r. Okay, so with the point wise addition and the point wise multiplication, we claim that this cx comma r is not an integral domain. Okay, so how to prove it is not an integral domain? So you fix a point x naught belongs to x. First you define a function f, so f from x to r, such that f of x equal to 1 if x equal to x naught, 0 otherwise. Okay, then this is arbitrary function from x to r, but every function from x to r is continuous. You see, if you look at these kind of functions, we saw these functions are not continuous as a function from r to r. Okay, but now if you change the topology to be discrete topology, all the functions are continuous in function. In particular, this function is also continuous function. Similarly, here I define another function g. At x naught, it takes 0. Everywhere, it takes 1. Okay. So, sort of the function values are complementary to each other. Okay. Now, if you look at the product of these two functions, so in cx comma r, addition is point-wise addition. multiplication is point wise multiplication. Okay, so what is f dot g of x? That is what we want to prove, we want to find. So f dot g dot x equal to f of x into g of x. This is the definition. So suppose if I put x equal to x naught, okay, then f dot g of f dot g of x naught will be f of x naught times g of x naught. Then g of x naught will be zero. Therefore, this product will be zero. So for x equal to x naught, we'll get zero. If f is not, if x is not equal to x naught, then for in that case f will be zero. Therefore, this this quantity will be again zero. So what we are concluding is, if you multiply these two functions, we are getting zero function. But these two functions are non-zero functions. Okay, non-zero functions means it is not identically zero. Okay, so here you can find two non-zero elements whose product is zero. That means that these two are zero divisors. So this is not an integral domain. Okay.
Okay.
Okay. So let's look at x equal to open 0 comma 1 union open 2 comma 3. So this is a like a union of two intervals. So you can take the usual metric here. Okay. So it will be a metric space in the usual metric. So we define like this can be written as A union B. This is my A, this is my B. And we look at the characteristic function chi A. So what is the definition of characteristic function chi A? In the points of A, it will take one, otherwise it is zero. Okay, so in open 0 comma 1, it takes the value 1, otherwise 0. Similarly, chi B of X will be in the points of B, it will take 1, otherwise it is 0. This is the definition of characteristic function. So now these two are non-zero functions and these two are continuous functions also. So it is continuous because it is maybe you can use a sequence argument. That is much easy to prove. Here it is constant function 1. Here it is constant function 0. Since these two sets are disconnected sets, you will get continuity. Just only 1 minute. Sorry, I got a lot of sneezing suddenly. Yeah. Anyways, so this is a disconnected space, and like in each of the components, this is constant. Okay, so you can verify that these functions are continuous functions. You can use a sequence criterion, or you can use the epsilon delta definition also. So we have checked how, in our first lecture, we saw how to prove some functions are continuous functions. So using that, you can prove that these two functions are actually continuous functions. Okay, therefore both of them belongs to C x comma R. Okay. And these two are non-zero continuous functions belongs to C x comma R. But if you look at that product, okay, so chi a, if you multiply two characteristic function, that is equal to characteristic function of the intersection, okay, intersection of these two sets. Now a intersection b is empty, okay, because a is this set, b is this set, a intersection b is empty. So characteristic function of empty set, that is basically constant function zero. Okay, so you can directly multiply these two functions also. Okay, so if you take chi a chi b of x, so chi a chi b of x, this will be equal to chi a of x into chi b of x. Okay, now if you take a point x here, then chi b will vanish. If you take a point x here, chi a will vanish. Okay, so at every point, either this function or this function will vanish. So this function will be identically zero. Okay. Okay, so we conclude that c x comma r is not an integral domain. Okay, so let's move on to c 0 comma 1. So c 0 comma 1 means continuous function from closed 0 comma 1 to R. So again, this is not again an integral domain. Okay, so we look at again, we constructed two continuous functions, two non-zero continuous function here whose product is zero. Okay, so this is the graph of my first function f of x. Okay, so f of x is zero in the interval closed to 0 1 by 2, and after 1 by 2 it is increases to 1 by 2 from 0 to, it is increases to 1 by 2 in the interval closed to 1 by 2, 1. Okay. So this, I have drawn the graph. Okay. So if I draw the graph, how to write down the function explicitly. Okay. Note that this point is 1 by 2 comma 0 in the xy plane. This point is 1 comma 1 by 2. See, this is 1, x coordinate is 1, y coordinate is 1 by 2. So this is nothing but line joining 1 by 2 comma 0 and 1 comma 1 by 2. So what is the equation for line joining 1 by 2 comma 0 and 1 comma 1 by 2? So you take these points as x1, y1, this point x2, y2, then line joining two points will be x minus x1 by x2 minus x1 equal to y minus y1 by y2 minus y1. Okay, so if you substitute in that formula, you get y equal to x minus 1 by 2. Here you substitute y equal to f of x. So you will get f of x equal to x minus 1 by 2. Okay, so in this interval, the graph is x minus 1 by 2. So we define f of x to be 0 in this interval, close interval 0 comma 1 by 2 and x minus 1 by 2 in closed interval 1 by 2 comma 1. So not that in the, so in 1 by 2, at the point 1 by 2, this function is also 0, this function also 0. So we can include 1 by 2 in both here also we can include 1 by 2, no problem, because function takes the same value. Okay, so similarly, we define another continuous function. So this is 0 in closed interval 1 by 2 comma 1, and here it is increases from 1 by 2 to 1, this direction. Okay, so similarly, this is the line joining 1 by 0 comma 1, this is 1 by 2 comma 0, this is 0 comma 1 by 2. So if you look at the line joining these two points, you will get 1 by 2 minus x. Okay, so in this interval 0 close to 0 1 by 2, you take 1 by 2 minus x, and in the closed interval 1 by 2 comma 1, it is 0 function. Okay, now if you multiply these two functions f and g, So I mean, it is, their product is zero. It is clear, right? Like if you calculate f into g of x, this is equal to f of x into g of x, and x is coming from close 0 comma 1. So close 0 comma 1, like close 0 1 by 2 union closed 1 by 2 comma 1. We can split close 0 comma 1 like this. If x belongs to this interval, close 0 1 by 2, then f of x will be 0. Therefore, f of x will be 0. Therefore, if x belongs to this interval, then f dot g of x is 0. If x belongs to this interval, then g of x will be 0. So for every x, this f dot g of x will be 0. Therefore, f dot g is a constant function 0. But f is not a 0 function, g is not a, I mean, f and g are non-zero continuous function whose product is 0. Therefore, C01 is not an integral domain. But maybe one thing is, like, if you look at the graph, you can see that it is clearly continuous. But there is a nice way to prove that these functions are continuous. F and g are continuous. Suppose A equal to x union y, and f from x to b is continuous, f g from y to b is continuous, and if f of a equal to g of a for all a belongs to intersection x intersection y, then you define a new function h of x equal to, so h of x equal to f of a for a belongs to x, g of a for a belongs to y, then this h of x is also continuous. So you have a continuous function on x, you have a continuous function on y. So by gluing them together, we are constructing a continuous function on A. Okay. So then this the resulting function is continuous if in the intersection, the function should take the same value. But that is what we observe. Only 1 minute.
உனக்கு 5000 கட்டணும்ல, 500 உனக்கு சும்மா அப்படி ரோட்ல கிடக்க.
Sorry, let's continue. So closed interval, maybe let's me write here, closed interval 0 comma 1 can be written as union of these two sets. Okay, so this function is a continuous function on here, this function is a continuous function here, and their intersection is just 1 by 2, like so this is my y, x intersection y will be just a singleton 1 by 2. Okay, these two functions take the same value at 1 by 2, that is equal to 0. Therefore, so by this result also, we can conclude that g of x is continuous. This is called a pasting lemma or gluing lemma. Okay, anyway, so let's go to the next one. So C01 is not an integral domain. That is what we just observed. Similarly, we go to C prime of closed 0 comma 1. C prime of closed 0 comma 1 means set of all functions from closed 0 comma 1 to R. F is continuously differentiable. Continuously differentiable does not mean that you can like f double dash, f triple dash, you can keep calculating the derivative. That is not its meaning. Okay. Continuously differentiable means that function is one time differentiable, but the derivative function is continuous. Okay. So usually many times we misunderstood that continuously differentiable means it you can continuously differentiate it. No, that is not true. Yeah, so continuously differentiable functions are definitely they are one time differentiable. You don't know whether it is two times differentiable or not. Okay. What we know is derivative is continuous. Okay. So again, we can prove that this C prime of closed 0 comma 1. This is again a ring. You can verify point wise addition and multiplication will be there. But this ring is also not an integral domain. Okay. So like last case, you can consider these functions. Okay. So if you look at the last example, this function is not differentiable at the point 1 by 2. Okay. So if you look at if you look at 1 by 2, you can see that there will be some sharpness here. Okay, so from the differentiability class, you know that if there is some sharpness, that function is not differentiable. So you can explicitly check that this function is not differentiable at 1 by 2. So right derivative at the point 1 by 2 will be 1, left derivative at the point 1 by 2 will be 0. Therefore, this function is not differentiable at 1 by 2. So to prove C prime of closed 0 comma 1 is not an integral domain, we need some other functions. Okay. So you take x minus 1 by 2 whole square. Instead of x minus 1 by 2, 1 by 2 minus x the whole square instead of 1 by 2 minus x. Okay. Then the graph will change like this. Okay, now you will get smoothness. I mean, not smoothness, you will get one time differentiability. Okay, just only 1 minute. I will show you this. I think I have closed that link. Here it is. So, if you notice, this is the book Rings and Modules. So, in the cover itself, they have given this this graph. Whatever we are talking about, this graph only they have printed in the cover image. Okay. Yeah. Okay. So anyway, so you check that this function is differentiable at 1 by 2. This function is also differentiable at 1 by 2. So at other points, differentiability is not a problem. So this function, both C prime of closed 0 comma 1. Because they are differentiable everywhere and the derivative is continuous for these two functions, but their product is zero. Okay, therefore C prime of 0, 1 is also not an integral domain. Okay, so more generally, we look at Cn of closed 0 comma 1. Okay, this means that n times continuously differentiable functions. That means that up to nth derivative exists. Okay, suppose if you look at C3 of closed 0 comma 1, first derivative exists, second derivative exists, third derivative exists, and the third derivative will be continuous. Okay, so we look at all such functions. Nth derivative exists and the nth derivative continuous also. And similarly, we look at C infinity of closed 0 comma 1. This is what infinitely differentiable functions. So infinitely differentiable means derivative of all order exists. Okay. So now again, this is also not integral domain. This is also not integral domain. So here we look at C1. One time differentiable functions whose derivative is continuous, right? So this C prime close 0 comma 1 also means that C1 of C 0 comma 1. So if you have 1 here, you have the power 2 here, right? So to prove Cn close 0 comma 1 is not an integral domain, so you put n plus 1 here. Here also you put n plus 1. These functions will be n times differentiable, and nth derivative will continuous also, and that will be the example. Okay, so here one, then you have two.
Hello sir, you are muted.
Wait sir. Yes, he is.
No. Actually, I was speaking only. I forgot to unmute you. Okay. Okay. Anyway.
Okay, so sir. No CN problem. Okay.
CN of close 0 comma 1 is not an integral domain. Similarly, C infinity of close 0 comma 1 is also not an integral domain. Okay. So you can check here in this video. Like why it's if you for more details you can check why the C n of close 0 comma 1, C infinity of close 0 comma 1 are not integral domains. Okay, so I have more things to cover, so I just leave it. Okay, so anyway, none of these things are not integral domains, but there are sub rings of these rings which are integral domains. Okay, for example, you take set of all constant functions. Okay, so constant functions are infinitely differentiable because first derivative will be zero, then you keep differentiating it, you will get zero functions only, right? So set of all constant functions from close 0 comma 1 to R. So if this will be a subring, and so constant functions, so they are isomorphic to R comma plus comma dot, but this is a field, right? Therefore, even though this is not an integral domain, it has a subring which is an integral domain. Okay, even it is a field. Okay. Okay. So I'll take a 5 minutes break, and maybe we'll meet at 5:50 or so. Yeah.
Okay, sir.
Okay. Yeah. Hello. So let's continue. So,
okay, sir. Continue, sir.
Okay.
Yes. Continue.
So like so C01 is not an integral domain, and C infinity close irukumon is also not an integral domain. But inside that, there are subrings which are integral domains. For example, this is one example. But there is one more very important example. Ring of real analytic functions is a proper subset of infinitely differentiable functions, and this is also an integral domain. Okay, so what is the meaning of real analytic functions? So functions which has power series expansion. Okay, and so a function is infinitely differentiable doesn't mean that it will have power series expansion with the infinite radius of convergence. So in complex plane, if you remember, like analytic function means it will have power series expansion. Okay, similarly, in a real analytic function, we look at functions which has power series expansion about a point with the radius of convergence infinity. So in particular, that power series converges at every point of real number. So we'll see an example, like, so this is from Wikipedia page. So if you consider this function, f of x equal to e power minus 1 by x for positive x and 0 if x less than or equal to 0. Okay, then this function is a smooth function. Smooth function means it is infinitely differentiable, but this function is not analytic. Not analytic means this function has no power series expansion with the infinite radius of convergence. Okay, so please check this Wikipedia page about smooth functions which are not analytic functions. Okay, in complex plane, complex analysis, like in the complex differentiation, we won't have these kind of things, but in the real case we have example of infinitely differentiable functions, but they are not analytic. For example, this function. Okay, so if you collect functions satisfying these properties, which are real analytic functions inside all infinitely differentiable functions, this will be a subring, but this will be an integral domain. Okay, yeah, so these are all one, like in previous year CSIR, the problems were like, which of the following are integral domains? So some subsets of C0, 1 are given, and we have to say whether it is integral domain or not. So whatever we have seen so far, using that understanding, we can answer those problems. Yeah. So I have also collected some problems. So we will see. Okay. Now again, idempotent elements. What is the meaning of idempotent elements? So an element A belongs to R is said to be idempotent if A square equal to A. Okay. So if you look at the constant function 0, that definitely satisfies the condition A square equal to A. Similarly, if you look at the constant function 1, then that is also satisfies the condition A square equal to A in C0, 1. So in C0, 1, constant function 0, constant function 1, they are idempotent elements. In arbitrary ring also, you can look at the 0 and 1. They will be idempotent elements, but they are called trivial idempotent elements. Okay. Now, then one important result is Cx, R contains no non-zero idempotents. Okay. If and only if this set X is connected. Okay. So, like we go back and see, like see example 3. This open 0, 1 union 2, 3, that example. So if you note that this X is not connected, okay. And so you look at this function, chi A and chi B. So they take only the values 1 and 0. So if you look at chi A square, you will get again chi A only. Okay, therefore, so this is disconnected. So we will have non-trivial idempotents. Okay, so this is not a constant function 0. Again, this is not constant function 1 also. So you have example of idempotence which is not equal to constant function 0, not equal to constant function 1. Okay, so that is what that result is saying. Cx, R contains sorry. CX, R contains no non-zero idempotents if and only if X is connected. So in other words, if X is disconnected, then you will always have non-zero idempotents. Okay. So again, in CXR, units, nilpotent, idempotents, these problems are important. So you can check this video. Yeah. Then let's move on to unit. So unit means A belongs to R is said to be a unit if there exists B belongs to R such that A times B equal to 1. So in other words, this element A should have multiplicative inverse. Okay. So U of R is a set of all units of R. Okay. Note that if R comma plus comma dot, if it is R comma plus comma dot, if it is a ring, then with respect to multiplication, it is closed. Then associativity is there. Then identity element is there. Only inverse you don't have, right? In arbitrary ring, non-zero element need not have a multiplicative inverse. For example, if you look at z comma plus comma dot and the element 2 belongs to z, it has no multiplicative identity. 1/2 is the multiplicative inverse. Sorry, 1/2 is the multiplicative inverse of 2, but this 1/2 does not belong to z, right? But here in the units, we are collecting the elements which has multiplicative inverse, right? So if you look at UR, units of R, it is as you can think of as a subgroup, subset of R comma dot. Then in this subset, like product of two units is again a unit. For example, AB, if A and B are units, then AB the whole inverse will be B inverse times A inverse. Okay. Therefore, in U of R, multiplication is a well-defined binary operation. I mean, U of R is closed under multiplication. And every element in U of R has, by definition, multiplicative inverse also. Because by definition, U of R contains element which has multiplicative inverse. Okay. So A times B equal to 1 means that B equal to A inverse. Right. Therefore, this UR is a group under multiplication always. So given a ring, you can always form U of R, units of R. So even though R star, non-zero ring elements with respect to dot, this may not be a group, but units of R with respect to dot always a group. Okay. So now let's come to Zn. So in Zn, we want to understand when an element is a unit. So let A belongs to Zn. Suppose A and GCD of A comma N equal to 1. Okay. So if GCD of A comma N equal to 1. So in general, if A GCD, suppose GCD of A comma N equal to D, then this GCD can be written as integer linear combination of these two elements. Okay. So that is a property of greatest common divisor. So in particular, this GCD 1 can be written as integer linear combination of these two numbers. Okay. So we get Ra plus Sn equal to 1. Now in Zn, any multiple of n is 0. So we get Ra equal to 1. So if A comma n equal to 1, then you can find R such that Ra equal to 1. In other words, this A is unit. Okay. Therefore, units of Zn are precisely set of all 1 less than or equal to A less than n, such that A and N have GCD 1. So now if you look at this set, the pi of N, the Euler-Totient function is defined to be, by definition, cardinality of this set is what? Is defined to be pi of N. Therefore, number of units in the group Zn is equal to pi of N. Okay. So this is a very important question in the group theory. You can check internet when this units group, when it will be cyclic. Okay. So anybody know when this U of Zn is cyclic? So if n is of the form some 2 times p power n, some 2 power n, some answer is there for this problem. When U of Zn
is 2, 4 p power e and 2 p power e, p odd pi.
Can you please repeat?
2, 4 p power e. At 2 p power e, p odd prime, like p prime greater than 1.
So p is odd prime.
Greater than 2. P odd prime.
P power k, then 2 times p power k. This is what you are saying?
Yes, sir.
Ah, okay. So for these values of n only, so units of Zn will form a cyclic group. There are some CSI problems asked in connection with this result. Okay. So please check the proof also. Why in these cases only this group is cyclic? That is very important result. Okay. Now, okay, let's move on to, okay, let's quickly see this remark. It is a remark only, then we'll see previous CSI problems. So R is a commutative ring with unity. Then we can look at M and R. So set of all N by N matrices with entries from the ring R. Okay. So usually we take this ring to be field. So we, so far we have seen M and of R and M and of C. So both of them are field. Okay. But in general, you can look at M and of R, N by N matrices with the entries from the ring R. So now, for example, you can look at M and of Z4. Z4 comma addition modulo 4 comma multiplication modulo 4 is a ring. We are looking at a set of all N by N matrices with the entries from this ring Z4. So we want to understand the units of this ring. Okay. So when a matrix is a unit in M and R. Okay. Note that we are looking at commutative rings. So now the answer is A is invertible. The matrix is invertible if and only if determinant of A is a unit in R. Okay, so usually matrix is invertible if and only if determinant of A is not equal to 0. That is what we saw. But that is true only in the case of field. Okay, if you are looking at arbitrary ring R, then A is invertible if and only if determinant of A is a unit in R. Let's see why this is the case. So this identity is always true. A times Aja equal to Aja times A equal to determinant of A times identity. Okay, so now you want to you want to divide by determinant of A. Okay. But when can you divide by determinant of A? You want this element to be unit. Okay. So if this element is unit, it means that it will have multiplicative inverse. Right. So that multiplicative inverse will be 1 by determinant of A. Okay. So determinant of A, if it is a unit, if it has multiplicative inverse, then by that multiplicative inverse we can multiply all these elements, you will get right hand side identity. So the answer will be A inverse equal to 1 by determinant of A at 0. Right. So this is the answer. A is invertible if and only if determinant of A is a unit in R. But in case of R is a field, in a field every non-zero element is unit. Okay. Therefore, determinant of A is a unit in R. It is the same as saying that determinant of A is not equal to 0 in case R is a field. Okay, that is why in our vector spaces, when we study vector spaces over R, over C, to prove that matrix is invertible, we prove that its determinant is not equal to 0. Same thing if you want to prove it over arbitrary ring, you have to prove that the determinant is a unit in R. Okay. So that is one thing. There are some NBHM questions also. So which of the following matrices are invertible over like Z4, Z6, like that. So you have to calculate the determinant and check whether determinant, that number, is a unit in the ring Z4 or Z6. So in general, M and R, set of all N by N matrices with the entries from the ring R, can have non-trivial zero divisors, nilpotent elements, idempotent elements. So for example, you take even R to be field. Okay. So if you take R to be field R also, then even if you assume this is a field, even in that case, you will have zero divisors, nilpotent elements. So nilpotent matrices we have studied, right? Nilpotent matrices with real entries. So similarly, idempotent matrices with real entries. So basically matrices satisfying A square equal to A. You can easily find, for example, you can look at this like very simple 1, 0, 0, minus 1. You want A square equal to A, right? Can somebody say an example of a 2 by 2 matrix satisfying A square equal to A? 1, 0, 0, 1 will do. Yeah, so this square equal to 1, 0. So again, this is a matrix with real entries. Yeah, so in linear algebra, we have seen examples of many such things, nilpotent matrices. Zero divisors means product of two non-zero matrix can be zero, right? So for example, you take 0 1 0 0 0 0 0 1, if we multiply these two matrices, what we will get? We'll get 0 0 0 0, right? So these two are non-zero matrices, but their product is zero. Okay, so therefore these are all zero divisors. Yeah, now maybe we'll come back to Boolean ring after a while, because I have a lot of problems to cover. So these things are, we saw yesterday itself. So let I1 be the ideal generated by x power 4 plus 3x square plus 2, and I2 be the ideal generated by x cube plus 1. And we define f1 to be q of x divided by ideal generated by this polynomial. F2 is q of x divided by ideal generated by this polynomial. Okay. So then the options are like when these two, whether this f1 and f2 are fields or not. Okay. So yesterday we saw that if these polynomials are irreducible, then these ideals are maximal and these quotient rings will be field. Okay. So basically we want to understand when these, we want to know whether these two polynomials are irreducible or not. Okay. So so whether these two polynomials are irreducible.
Second one is reducible.
Second one is reducible. Why?
Because minus one is a root and it is a degree three polynomial.
No, like whenever it there is a root, it is reducible. For that we don't need a degree. Okay.
Yes. Yes.
So, so root implies reducible. That is always true. So this for this polynomial, minus one is a root. Therefore, this polynomial is reducible. Therefore, F2 is not a field. What about this polynomial?
Check by Eisenstein criteria.
What is the prime you want to consider?
Three.
Yes.
Three should divide two also, no? In Eisenstein, like all the coefficients of should be divided by 3, right? Except the leading coefficient.
Maybe we can replace x by x plus 1 and then we can check.
Okay. Yeah. So, I mean, I'm not sure whether Eisenstein will be useful. Like, as I said yesterday, like if the, all the powers are even, then better to substitute t equal to x square. So, then you'll get this is t square plus 3t plus 2. So, this is t plus 1 into 2 plus 2. So, now you've put back t equal to x square. So you get x power 4 plus 3x square plus 2 is equal to x square plus 1 into x square plus 2. So it is reducible. Okay. So I mean, Eisenstein might also work. You give it a try. Okay. Therefore, none of them are field because this is also reducible. This is also reducible. Okay. So again, what about this? I1 is the ideal generated by this polynomial. I2 is ideal generated by this polynomial. Then which of these things are field?
R1 is a field.
Why R1 is a field?
Because I1 is irreducible.
So this is irreducible because it has no roots. Okay. So it is a degree 2 or 3 polynomial. Irreducible if and only if it has no roots. So the roots of x square plus 1 are plus I and minus I. So but, it has no root in.
R2 it is not a field. Root in,
so it has no root in rational numbers, therefore this is a field. R1 is a field, right? What you are saying?
R2 is not a field because x is equal to 1 is a root.
Yes. Yeah, so if the sum of the coefficient is 0 for a polynomial, then 1 is always a root, right? So here 1 minus 1, 1 minus 1, sum of the coefficient is 0, therefore 1 is a root. So like x square plus 1 has no root in Q, therefore this is an irreducible polynomial. But this polynomial can be written as x minus 1 times g of x. So this is degree 3 polynomial. So this is degree 1 into this is degree 2. Therefore, this polynomial is reducible. So therefore, R1 is a field and R2 is not a field. Yeah. So what about this problem? Let P of x be the ideal generated by the polynomial P of x in Q of x. Suppose f of x equal to x cube plus x square plus x plus 1. G of x equal to x cube minus x square plus x minus 1. Then, so they are looking at sum of two ideals. Okay. And see, Q of x is a PID. Yesterday we saw something about PID. So PID means every ideal is generated by one element. Okay. If f is a field, then fx is a PID. Therefore, if you look at the ideal generated by f of x and the ideal generated by g of x, and if you look at their sum, this is a one ideal. Okay, sum of two ideal is again an ideal. So this ideal will also generated by one polynomial. What is that polynomial? That is the question. This polynomial, which polynomial it is? So anybody know how to do this problem?
So we have to compute GCD of two polynomial.
Yeah. Why GCD?
Because sum of two ideals, so is of the form A times R plus B times S, and right. AB. Here it is a linear combination, and we have to take the smallest linear combination. That is the GCD.
Right. They are correct. Exactly. That is what is correct. Yeah. So that is true in any Euclidean domain. Okay, so let's see why it is true. So let I and j be two ideals in a ring R. Then by definition, this I plus j is the smallest ideal containing both I and j. Okay, so you look at the set of all ideals containing both I and j, then take the intersection of them. That will be I plus j. Okay, so this is one definition of I plus j, sum of two ideals. Another definition is this I plus j is contains set of all RA, SB, such that this A belongs to I, B belongs to J, and this R and S are arbitrary element of the ring R. Okay, ideal generated, like ideal generated by I and J. So then this will be the smallest ideal containing both I and J. So this is the definition. Now, yesterday we saw that if R is a PID, so every ideal is of the... Every ideal is generated by one element. So I is generated by A, J is generated by B. We saw that one ideal contained in another ideal. I is contained in J if and only if the generator of B divides generator of I. Okay. So for example, like yesterday we saw that 4Z is contained in 4Z contained in 2Z. Because 2 divides 4. Okay, so the generator of the bigger ideal should divide the generator of the smaller ideal. So here the generator of the bigger ideal is have I written anything wrongly here? Two divides four, right? So here A should divide B, right? Am I right?
Yes, sir. Right.
This is correct. A divides B. A divides B. Yeah. Anyway, so what we are doing is, so you take I plus J. Okay, I plus J is an ideal, and if R is a PID, and so this I plus J is also an ideal. This will also be an ideal generated by one element, because in a principal ideal domain, every ideal is generated by one element, right? Now, this D has to be the GCD of these two elements. Okay, so that is the main important result. Again, you can look at ring theory, Musili. So I showed you the book a couple of times where he has given a very nice proof of this fact. So sum of two ideal is generated by the GCD of the respective generators. Okay, so proof is just two lines. So whatever he just said, that is the proof. But if you look at the book, it will be much better. You can see some nearby results also regarding PID. Okay, So sum of two ideals is always generated by the GCD of the generators. Okay. So for example, like if you look at 2EZ plus 3EZ. 2EZ plus 3EZ is generated by GCD of 2 and 3. GCD of 2 and 3 is 1. Therefore, 2EZ plus 3EZ is equal to 1EZ. 1EZ is EZ. Okay. So if you sum these two ideals, you will get EZ. And similarly, if you take intersection of two ideals, you will get LCM, 6EZ. Okay, so this 6 is LCM of these two results. So like I plus J, you can look at, you can take I intersection J also. This I intersection J is generated by LCM of A comma B. That is the result, okay? So by using this result, we can solve this problem. This result is true in any PID. So Q of X is a PID, okay? Now, so we know that this ideal Fx plus Gf, F of X plus G of X is going to generated by greatest common divisor of F of X and G of X, right? Now, how to find the greatest common divisor of these two polynomials? That is what we have to understand. So first, let's see how to find the greatest common divisor of two numbers. Then we use the same technique. Suppose you want to calculate the greatest common divisor of these two numbers. You find the prime factorization. And then you look at the common prime factors, common prime numbers occurring in both the places. Here, somehow, like these two numbers are same. But for example, like here, I just take 175 by 5 will be 35, right? So maybe we'll change to this number. Then, okay. So for example, I want to find the GCD of 100 and 35. So this is the prime factorization. Now I look at the common prime factors. So 5 square and 5. This is 5 is the only common prime factor occurring in both the places. And you take the least power. Okay. Suppose there are more than two prime factors are occurring in both the places. In each of prime number, you take the least power. Okay. So 5 power 1. Suppose there is here you have 3 square. Here you have 3 power 4. Then you take 3 square also here. Okay. So that will be the GCD. So we use the same technique here also. So you take the prime factorization, okay? So x cube plus x plus 1 can be written as x square plus 1 into x plus 1, okay? So this is a irreducible polynomial. This is a irreducible polynomial. Similarly, x cube plus x minus x square minus 1, this can be written as x square plus 1 into x minus 1. So this is the product of irreducible factors. Now, the only common factor occurring in both the places is x square plus 1. And the least power is 1. Okay. Therefore, GCD of these two polynomials is x square plus 1. Therefore, option C is the correct answer. Okay. So, other options are wrong. Like, because this is the GCD. So, this result is always true. I plus J is generated by GCD of A and B. So, here, GCD of f of x and g of x is what we have calculated. That is x square plus 1. Okay. Yeah, so we'll move on. Yeah, so which are the following integral domains are Euclidean domains? So please check what is the definition of Euclidean domain. So, like yesterday, we saw that Euclidean domain implies. Hello.
Sir, in the previous problem, we mainly used that QX is a PID, but what happens if it is not given that we are doing in the calculation in a PID, then how do we encounter such a sum? Means,
but we have used only PID, right? What is exactly your question? If the ring is not PID, what to do?
Yes.
I think if it is not PID, then it is very difficult. But we are working over polynomial ring, right? So if this is a field, then this will be always Euclidean domain. So it will be PID. But if you look at a polynomial ring over arbitrary ring, for example, if the same question, if it is asked over Z4 of X, okay? then it is very difficult to answer. But I haven't seen any such questions also. Even in NBHM or TAF or also usually I haven't seen any such questions over non-Euclidean rings, non-Euclidean domains. But if it is non-Euclidean domain, what you can do? Still the same result is true. You have to calculate the GCD only. But the ideals may not be generated by one element.
Yes. I mean, sir, then we can apply the definition. I mean, I plus J, what you define that RA plus SB, where R belongs
to R. This we can use. Okay, we can use it. This may be generated by one element. This may be generated by one element. This may not be generated by one element. If R is not a PID.
Yes.
So that may be problem. But in ring theory, if you don't assume nice assumptions, then like all possible strange things can happen. Okay, so really it will be messy. Yeah, so I'm not really know what happens if it is not a PID, but usually as far as I have seen, yeah, if you don't understand PID, then it will be very bad. Okay, yeah. So which are the following integral domains are Euclidean domains? So yesterday we saw that Euclidean domain implies PID, principal ideal domain implies unique factorization domain. So principal ideal domain means every ideal is generated by one element. In other words, every ideal is a principal ideal. Principal ideal is like cyclic groups. Cyclic groups are subgroups generated by one element. Principal ideals are ideals generated by one element. If all the ideals are principal ideal, then that ring is called the principal ideal domain. So domain means that integral domain. Okay, so there is something called the principal ideal ring also. In a non-ideal, if a ring is not integral domain, but every ideal is principal, that is called a principal ideal ring. But anyway, we always look at the domains. So this D means that they are all integral domains. So to prove something is not Euclidean domain, we will prove that they are not a principal ideal domain or they are not a unique factorization domain. Okay, if something is not UFD, then definitely it is not PID. So definitely it is not Euclidean domain also. So use this inclusion. Okay, so quickly we see what is unique factorization domain. So this is the Wikipedia definition of unique factorization domain. Your unique factorization domain is defined to be an integral domain R in which every non-zero element X can be written as product of irreducible elements and a unit. That is the definition in a unique way actually. So this is the definition of unique factorization domain. So unique means that unique up to reordering the factors. So for example, if you take any natural number n, it can be written as p1 power alpha 1, p2 power alpha 2, etc., pk power alpha k, right? It's a product of prime numbers. And this factorization is unique up to reordering the factors. For example, the same thing can be written as p2 power alpha 2, p1 power alpha 1, etc., pk power alpha k. So definitely this factorization is not unique because n can be written as well as this way also. But we assume that these two things are same factorization. This means that we are reordering. Reordering means we are putting the factors, this factor, we are just permuting the factors. Okay. So in a unique factorization domain, like in integers, every element can be written as product of irreducible elements and a unit also. So that unit means that for example, if it is a positive integer, you can put 1 here. If it is a negative integer, you can put minus 1. Then you can put the prime factorization of n. Right? So, this note that in integers, plus 1. So, units of integers are precisely 1 and minus 1. These are the only two elements which has multiplicative inverse in Z. So, 2... 3, 4, none of these elements has multiplicative inverse in Z. because 1 by 2, 1 by 3, 1 by 4, none of these elements are belongs to EZ. Okay. So same thing is what a unique factorization domain also means. Every non-zero element can be written as product of irreducible elements under unit. Okay. So this factorization should be unique. That is what is very important. Now we claim that so to prove some of them are not Euclidean domain, we prove that some of them are not PID. Not PID means not Euclidean domain. We prove that some of them are not UFD. Not UFD, then not Euclidean domain also. Okay, so let's do options one by one. So if you look at R of x square x cube, so this means that polynomials in x square and x cube. Okay, so if you take a product of x square and x cube and x square x cube separately, so you can form all the powers x square x cube. X square will be x power 4, x square into x cube will be x power 5, x cube square will be x power 6, then this x power 4 into x cube will give me x power 7. So all the higher powers can be formed by using only x square and x cube, but you cannot form x by using x square and x. Okay, therefore all the polynomials in R x square x cube will have coefficient of x will be 0. That is why they have given that a1 equal to 0. So this is set of all polynomials in R of x whose coefficient of x is 0. So the question is whether this is a Euclidean domain. That is not a Euclidean domain, because this x power 6 can be written as x cube into x cube. Also, it can be written as x square into x square. Okay. Now, we claim that this x cube and this x square both are irreducible elements. Okay. So, what is the meaning of irreducible elements? You take an integral domain and an element A belongs to R is said to be an irreducible element if you break A as B times C, then one of these elements has to be a unit. That is a definition of an irreducible element. Now we just saw, if you split x cube can be split as x square times x. There is no other way you can split x cube, right? But x is not an element of R x square x cube. Therefore, x cube cannot be splitted in R x square x cube. Therefore, x cube is irreducible in this ring. Similarly, x square can be splitted as x into x only. But x is not an element of this ring, right? Therefore, these two elements are irreducible. So x power 6, you are writing as product of irreducible elements in two different ways. Therefore, this is not a unique factorization domain. Therefore, this is not a unique fact, that this is not an PID. This is not ED also. Okay. So let's look at the next option. Z of root of minus 3. So this ring consists of elements of the form set of all a plus b minus root b square root of minus 3 such that ab belongs to Z. So this is again not a unique factorization domain, because you take the element 4. 4 can be written as 2 times 2. Also 4 can be written as 1 plus root 3i and 1 minus root 3i. Okay. So these two things are irreducible elements that requires proof. So this 4 can be written as product of irreducible elements in two different way. Therefore, set of root of minus 3 is not an unique factorization domain. So you can look at contemporary abstract algebra, Joseph A. Galien. This book where they discuss in the ring theory chapter, they discuss when Z of root n, where n is a square free integer. Okay. When this is a Euclidean domain. Okay, that they discuss. And for example, if you put n equal to minus 1, then you get a Z of I. Z of I is equal to set of all the ring of Gaussian integers, set of all a plus b, a plus ib, such that a comma b belongs to Z, right? So they discuss in this book, they discuss all these similar rings, and they also discuss when an element of this ring will be irreducible, when this will be equally determined. All these things are given here. Okay, so in particular, this is not a unique factorization domain. This is not unique factorization domain. Now, this is a unique factorization domain that we will see, but Z of X is not a PID. Therefore, again, this is not a Euclidean domain. Okay, because this is not a PID. So let's see why. So if you look at Z of X, so this is option 4. Z of X by ideal generated by 2 comma X. This is one ring. Over this ring, you look at the polynomials in the variable Y. Question is whether this is a Euclidean domain. So let's see. So one thing to observe is Z of X by ideal generated by X is isomorphic to Z. Okay, so how to prove this? You recall that yesterday we proved that C0, 1 divided by polynomials vanishing at the point A is isomorphic to R. Right? You imitate the same proof, you will get that Z of X by ideal generated by X is isomorphic to Z. Okay. So now, one thing you can, okay, so this is Z. So then you have to go modulo 2 also. So this will give you Z, then you have to go modulo 2 also. So basically that will be Z2. So this ring is, you can prove that this ring is isomorphic to Z2. So Z2 is a field, and I told you that if F is a field, then Fx is a Euclidean domain. Therefore, in the fourth option, this is an Euclidean domain. So what you can do, how to prove this isomorphism? So what you have to do, you have to construct a function, ring homomorphism from Zx to Z2, whose kernel is ideal generated by 2 comma x. Okay. And this should be an onto homomorphism also. Then Z of X by kernel isomorphic to Z2. Okay. So what is the, how do you define this map? Pi of polynomial X is equal to F of 0. So you send it to F of 0. That will give you some integer value. Okay. F of 0 will give you constant term of this polynomial. F is a polynomial with integer coefficient. So this will be an integer, but we want the answer in Z2. So what you can do, you take the bar. So this bar means that you consider the, okay, maybe I'll use different notation. So you take so image will be F of 0 modulo 2. Okay, so you'll get some integer, then you take modulo 2. Okay, so that is the image. Then it will be in Z2. If you calculate the kernel will be precisely ideal generated by 2 1 dx. Okay. Yeah. So I hope this definition is clear. So that for that reason, this ring is isomorphic to Z2. If F is a field, then F of X is an Euclidean domain. Okay. So this option is true. Only we have to prove that Zx is not a PID. So if you noticed here, suppose Zx is a PID. In PID, every prime ideal is a maximal ideal. That's what we said yesterday, right? So now you look at ideal generated by X. This is a prime ideal because Zx by ideal generated by X isomorphic to an integral domain. Okay. So this is an integral domain. Therefore, this is a prime ideal. This is not a field. Therefore, this is not a maximal ideal. Therefore, in Z of X, there is an ideal which is prime ideal but not maximal. In a principal ideal domain, every principal ideal is maximal. Therefore, Z of X is not a principal ideal domain. Okay. So there is one more way of proving that Z of X is not a PID. So ideal generated by 2 comma x, this is not a principal idea that one can prove. So I share the notes. Okay, why it is not a principal ideal, you can check the proof. Okay. So these are all two important things. So as I said, every Euclidean domain is principal ideal domain. Every principal ideal domain is unique factorization domain. But there are unique factorization domains which are not principal ideal domains. That example is very important. Similarly, there are principal ideal domains which are not Euclidean domains. So that is also important. So when I check in Wikipedia, so they have given some nice examples. All Euclidean domains are principal ideal domains, but the converse is not true. An example of a principal ideal domain that is not a Euclidean domain is Z of, in Z, you are adjoint this element, 1 plus root of minus 19 by 2. Okay. Then this will be a principal ideal domain. This will be a principal ideal domain, but it is not an Euclidean domain. Okay. Again, these things are discussed in Galien book, Contemporary Abstract Algebra, Joseph A. Galien. Similarly, if you look at Kx, y, polynomial in two variables, this is a unique factorization domain. Why it is a unique factorization domain? Because field is you can look at Kx. Okay, so if K is a field, then Kx is a Euclidean domain. That's what I said. Therefore, Kx is a unique factorization domain. Okay. Another result is if R is UFD, then Rx is also UFD. Okay, therefore, if Kx is UFD, then Kxy, this is equal to K of x, y, this is also UFD. So you can keep adding variables. Okay, all those will be unique factorization domain. So this will be a unique factorization domain, but this is not a ID because ideal generated by x and y, that is not a principal ideal. That cannot be generated by one element. Okay. Okay. So let's look at this problem. The number of non-trivial ring homomorphism from Z12 to Z28. Okay, so there is a nice formula. The number of ring homomorphism from Zm to Zn is equal to 2 power omega of n minus omega of n by GCD of m, comma n. Okay, so please check the proof of this fact. Remember the result, the proof also important in proving similar problems regarding ring homomorphisms. So now omega of n, what is omega of n? The number of distinct prime divisors of n. Okay, so n, Zm to Zn, so the codomain is n. Okay, so what is 28, right? So what is the prime factorization of 28? 2 square into 7, right? So therefore, number of prime factors of 28 is 2. Okay, so W of n is 2. Now 28 by GCD of m comma n is 4. So 28 by 4, that is equal to 7. Okay, so therefore you get W of n by GCD of m comma n equal to W of 7. The number of distinct prime divisors of 7 is 1. Therefore, this number is equal to 2 minus 1, 1. Therefore, there will be 2 ring homomorphism from Z12 to Z28. Okay. Yeah. So next problem. Like, which of the following are Euclidean domain or unique factorization domain or PID? That is the question. So first option is QX. Q is a field, therefore QX will be a Euclidean domain. Therefore, if it's Euclidean domain, PID, UFD, everything we will get. Now let's look at this ring, union n equal to 1 to infinity Q of x power 1 by n. Then this is not a unique factorization domain. because x can be written as x power 1 by 2, not that x power 1 by 2 is also there. You need n equal to infinity x power 1 by m. So x power 1 by 2 square and x power 1 by 3 cube. So x can be written as two different factorizations. So therefore, it is not a UFD. Okay. So this is not a UFD. Therefore, this is not a Euclidean domain also. U of x, y, z. This is not an Euclidean domain because ideal generated by x, y. So always, whenever you have more than one variable, this ideal generated by x, y cannot be generated by one element. Therefore, this will not be a PID. Okay, so remember that this will not be PID. Whenever you have more than one variable, it will not be PID. But it will be unique factorization domain because I just so tell you that we can keep adjoining the variables because QX is a Euclidean domain. Therefore, QX is unique factorization domain. So if sum ring is unique factorization domain, you can adjoin one more variable that will remain unique factorization domain. Therefore, QXY is UFD. Similarly, QXYZ also UFD. Okay. So this is an unique factorization domain, which is not a prime, which is not Euclidean domain also. Again, this is not unique factorization domain. This is Euclidean domain. Okay. Okay. So maybe I'll share the notes. Some of the things I didn't cover that you can check in the notes. Okay. So if you have some doubts, you can ask me or we'll just stop the lecture here.
Okay, sir. Arun, sir.
Yes, madam.
Meena Kumari, madam. I invite Mrs. Meena Kumari to thank our Arun Kumar, sir. Meena, ma'am.
Okay, ma'am. Thank you, ma'am. Okay, ma'am. Am I audible, ma'am?
Audible, ma'am.
Hello?
You are audible. You are audible, ma'am.
Good evening to all. Okay. Good evening to all. I am very much happy to thank the resource person, Dr. G. Arun Kumar, sir, IASC Bangalore, for being a part of this online national workshop on enriching problem-solving skills in pure and applied mathematics, organized by our Department of Mathematics, MEPCOSLANK Engineering College, Sivahasi. I thank him for his excellent flow of lecture on analysis and algebra. His interesting lecture makes us to improve our problem approaching techniques in both the subjects, algebra and analysis. So thank you, sir, for your wonderful and excellent lecture. On behalf of our college management, I thank him once again for being a resource person of this online workshop. Thank you once again, sir. Thank you. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, madam. And also thanks for the opportunity.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much.
Okay. Okay.
Hello,
sir.
Sir, before you going to like stop the video, sir, I need to ask that one question. See, the resources you have given is very fantastic for like NBHM and that objective and subjective exam for both, sir. But sir, somehow I was trying to solve the questions for the JRF, ISI JRF questions.
Okay.
They are a bit hard for me to solve. Can you suggest some suggestions? Can you give them to approach them? Or you can suggest some references for which I can go.
Okay. So maybe I'll share the textbooks in our WhatsApp group. I'll share the name of the books in the WhatsApp groups.
Yeah, sure. Sure. That would be fantastic.
Okay.
Sure. Thank you so much.
Okay, sir.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir. Thank you very much.
Okay.
Thank you so much,
thank
sir.
You. Okay. Yeah, welcome.